to see everybody here. It's so great. Thank you all for coming to the first event, CLIC's events of the winter 2018. Welcome to my copyright students. Thank you very much for coming here and make up for our snow day, and to all the faculty who are here. I am so pleased to welcome Professor Orly Lobel, who comes from the University of San Diego, where she is the Don Weckstein Professor of Employment and Labor Law. Orly has written a very, very important book previous to this book called Talent Wants to Be Free, which is a book about the labor markets and labor mobility. This book, as she'll talk about, connects to that book, but it is about the Barbie and Bratz litigation and a lot more. What I want to tell you, she's going to tell you the whole story, the background, and how it evolves, and all the interesting ins and outs. Let me just tell you a little bit about Orly. She has an SJD from Harvard Law. She clerked on the Supreme Court of Israel, born in Israel, was a visiting professor at Tel Aviv University Law Faculty for some time, taught at Harvard Law School, so she is no stranger to this parts, but she resides in sunny San Diego, so we don't get to see her all that often. When she comes this way, we're on her book tour, we are glad to have her stop in and talk with us. The book that she's going to be talking about, this great book, is in the bookstore. If anyone's interested, there's a flyer here for people who want to be reminded. It was also reviewed yesterday in The New Yorker by Jill Lepore. The book review is not as great as the book, but I would encourage you to read it if you're interested in that. She's going to speak with PowerPoints for about 25-ish minutes, and then there'll be plenty of time for Q&A. Okay, and anyone, there's snacks and stuff outside. That has to all be finished before. All right, thank you.
Thank you. So this is such a pleasure to be here, and I want to say that Jessica Silvey, Professor Silvey, is really the reason that I'm here on this mini book tour. So I'm giving 4 talks in 2.5 days, but this was the talk that started it all and really motivated me to come in January to beautiful Boston. That was beautiful. But beyond that, I'm also really, in general, in my research, have been so inspired by Jessica's work. So her book, The Eureka Myth, we all learned from so much about what really motivates inventors and how intellectual property is thought about or understood, perceived, you know, in the background of so much of our creative and inventive industries. And she actually does that, you know, hard empirical work that we all learn so much from. So I have to say, I don't know if I actually told Jessica in person this, but for me, this book was a new adventure into doing more of an empirical work, and I interviewed a lot of different players in the battling companies, the executives, the judges, the jurors, the attorneys, and I think really Jessica's work was inspiring, and her sort of vision was motivating and encouraging in that sense. So thank you for having me and for all of that. So this book is really telling a full story, and I thought I could start with, from the introduction, just reading you the very first paragraph in the very first, it's not even the chapter one, it's an introduction. She was blonde and beautiful, statuesque, with long slender legs, tiny waist, and a chest so large that Finnish researchers claimed any similarly endowed woman would surely tip over. For years, Carter Bryant dutifully served her. He styled her hair, dressed her in skirts, dresses, and luxurious gowns, adorned her in jewelry, and even applied her makeup. She always looked fabulous. Day after day, week after week, she was unblemished, shiny and new. And in a $3 billion industry, she dominated over 90% market share for 5 decades. Perhaps that was what Carter despised. Her perfection, the absence of a single flaw. She never changed. While people gained weight, their skin wrinkled and sagged, and their hair gray, Barbie stood perfect and frozen against a changing world. Everything was raunchier and more perverse. Barbie remained maddeningly clean. A real artist, Carter saw beauty in the broken, the peculiar, the queer, perhaps even the grotesque. Like many creative people trapped in dead-end jobs, he experienced the angst of a servant whose golem had become the master. He imagined a new icon that better reflected the modern world, using the beauty of real people. Carter had not intended to assault Barbie's persona, her public image, or those invested in maintaining it. He hadn't even planned to confront his master. He could not have consciously dared to dream of the millions he would make from his rebellion, the millions in ensuing losses, and the decade-long legal battle that would not only change Barbie and the Mattel Corporation, but forever alter both the entire toy industry and the very laws governing creativity and competition. He certainly couldn't have foreseen the incredibly ferocious feud between his overpowering ex-employer and the flamboyant entrepreneur who gambled and risked it all to take a chance on him. Nor did he predict that lawyers would drag both his life partner, Richard Ehrman, and his mother, Jane, to testify on his behalf, asking them to reveal deep-seated, intimate details of his life and passions. Most certainly, his dreams would not include suffering depression and a stroke at the age of 41. Carter Bryant only wanted to build his own dream house away from Barbie. That's a really very first paragraph, and it starts with an unlikely hero who, you know, part of the story is how he disappears. It's almost like the Greek tragedy when, you know, you have to kill the father of this creation for her to survive. And he sort of, during the decade-long trial, you can kind of see his change and his involvement and just really his silencing where the two giants, although it, in a lot of senses it's a David versus Goliath story, with the two battling companies, because we have Mattel on the one side that's publicly held, the dominant, you know, number one toy maker in the world for decades, going after a new entry, an entrepreneur, an immigrant, Isaac Larian, but a very, very strong personality, bold entrepreneur, who is the founder and owner of the largest privately held company in toy making company in the United States. The largest, really, because he risked it all and went after the dominance of this fashion doll that had no competitors. As the judges say, it was the first time that Barbie was knocked off her pedestal, and she has, you know, a real competitor in the toy season, in the holiday season, for the first time at the turn of the century in 1999, 2000, she starts seeing the decline, and we see a new doll really taking over such a big market share. So the story really starts there, where Mattel doesn't really know where it came from. You know, like, how is there a new competitor? And it doesn't really know the origins, to leading back to Carter Bryant's idea of developing a new bratty doll, until it receives an anonymous letter after the doll is already out there, after Bratz is such a huge success. An anonymous letter from Hong Kong saying, you know what? It's your former employee that had the seed of the idea and had these, like, first sketches that were then sold to your competitor, and they developed a new doll empire. And one of the things that really drew me to the case was how, you know, basically mad, you know, just crazy the executives at Mattel went when they find this out, and they really, you see these internal memos that say, this means war, it's genocide, it's Barbie genocide, PowerPoints and really, like, screens with fire going on. And they make a decision not to At some point, they also try some failed, like, competitive lines with, you know, for the first time, actually presenting other alternatives to Barbie from the inside, which they have not wanted to do for years. And the other thing that I find when talking to executives and looking at these internal memos that come out in Discovery is that they very often use the word cannibalize. They do not want to cannibalize. For years, they do not want to cannibalize Barbie. She's their doll. They don't want to. It's like the, you know, classic economic model of Kenneth Arrow. If you have a concentrated market, a dominant, one dominant producer, there's no incentive to create new lines. But for the first time, they're thinking, yeah, maybe we can do something that's like a multi-ethnic line that's more bratty, more edgy, sort of like Bratz. But mostly their whole focus goes to litigation. And it's a roller coaster trial. One of the things that was really fantastic and I think a reason for telling the story is that this trial happens twice. And it really made me be able to uncover how much the personalities of the litigants, that so it happens twice with two different judges, because there's really three courts, because it goes on appeal to the Ninth Circuit and then it's remanded, and we have a new judge, we have a new team of attorneys, which makes a huge difference, and you know, one of the heroes of the story is the new attorney that comes on to the MGA team in the second trial, and kind of shifts the whole discourse in the before the jury. A new set of jurors, and I got to interview jurors on that sat on the jury, and just makes a huge difference. And also and the second trial, again, very important, counterclaims and a lot of new facts come out about actually Mattel's corporate culture and practices and unethical economic espionage and all kinds of antitrust questions. So it becomes much bigger than just that initial question of whether the fact that this designer from Mattel, Carter Bryant, who, according to his story, drew some sketches while he was on leave, actually, from Mattel, and disillusioned and you know, frustrated with Mattel's not wanting to take any of his ideas because he had proposed all kinds of ideas previously, whether that fact gives then Mattel ownership over a new competitor brand, you know, a whole empire that was created, invested, marketed, and was selling really well. And again, the answers in the courts are, you know, that's the roller coaster thriller of this case, that, you know, you might think it's sort of an easy question, you might have reactions to this, and it becomes really, really interesting to see what kind of evidence comes out, how do you find that eureka moment, how do you prove it, what kinds of evidence, he has his whole story about what inspired him. They have a whole different story, and it's a really fascinating case. But I'm going to step back now and tell you about sort of what led me to start delving into the case, which I at first didn't know had so much to tell, but I was interested in it in that sort of paradigmatic case of an ex-employee battling it out about ideas. So I've been studying these questions about knowledge flows and about job mobility, talent coaching, and how we create an event for quite a while. And I'll just say tonight at the Coop, at the Harvard Coop bookstore, I'm doing another event and C-SPAN is gonna be there. And I won't get to, like right now I really wanna focus on that side of the intellectual property meets human capital and all that, but there's a lot of other things that, like, about consumer psychology and parenting and the gender aspects and all that. And so I really would love for all of you to also come to the Harvard Coop tonight at 7 and tell your friends I don't want to be there alone in the snow. But it really will be different and more. So on these questions about human capital and mobility. As Jessica said, I wrote a couple of years ago a book where I argued that really under the radar, we were controlling more knowledge, more types of information, more creative production than what we were seeing in our intellectual property debates. So we were debating in a very visible way, in a very public way, about the right lines to draw in patent law, in copyright law, trademark, trade secrets also, but trade secrets is a little bit the stepchild of intellectual property, kind of the fourth pillar that we don't talk about enough, and that's actually an area that I've been writing about a lot, and I'll say more about that. But we have those kind of visible statutes, federal statutes. We have the Supreme Court cases almost every year about like what is patentable, what can be copyrightable. There's really kind of very clear significance of these cost-benefit analysis, the deals that we strike in monopolizing some knowledge and setting everything else free in the commons. But under the radar, I was seeing that there was a real expansion of the fencing activity by sort of law, bodies of law outside of traditional intellectual property, mostly through contract and employment doctrines. Like the duty of loyalty and what employees owe their employers during employment and post-employment, the expansion of the use of non-compete agreements and NDA agreements, and the language there was just ever increasing and really kind of throwing away what we knew about intellectual property bargains. And I wrote several more articles about these different aspects. I did some experimental studies about how non-competes, for example, have this demotivating effect on people when they're stripped from their own human capital and their ability to use their skills, their network, what they've been gaining the experience throughout their career. Their performance is sort of declined, that they feel less connected to their job. And so there's a motivational aspect, and I did some work on trade secrets along with my co-author Rochelle Dreyfus at NYU. We were showing how again there's that really we should think about trade secret expansion and the Defend Trade Secret Act that was passed in 2016 as regulating employment relationship. As much as anything else, and probably more, because statistically, the vast majority of trade secret litigation is actually between employers and ex-employees. And it was actually really interesting for me to be working on this and living in California and having, in the area of non-competes, a real comparative angle there where in the area of non-competes, we have the exceptional law in California, section 16600 in the California Business Code that we've had since the inception of the state, where all non-competes in the context of employment relations are void, and everywhere else they're enforced within reason. Again, you're using the standard of reasonableness. And that created a lot of interest actually by economists across different campuses to start looking at this empirically and looking at the differences and impact on innovation, on regional growth, on startups, on VC investment, a lot of great studies. It was an exciting moment for me a few years ago writing this and kind of looking at all of the great work that's being done to show that actually less confinement of talent and the ability to compete when you were an insider and were exposed to all kinds of inside information, technologies, creative work, strategies, and then still be able to join a competitor or found your own company, that Silicon Valley actually is a paradigmatic example of actually winning out in not allowing employers to say, no, now you can't be in this career, in this industry. And in fact, it's not just Silicon Valley. So I live in Southern California, and sometimes people said, oh, so maybe it's just the tech industry. But it was really clear that there are a lot of industries that were in that, you know, equilibrium that I thought was a more optimal equilibrium, where, you know, in San Diego we have pharma industry, biotech, medical devices, really thriving without the ability of making an employee sign a non-compete. And other nations, when I was clerking on the Missouri Supreme Court, we actually had this important decision checkpoint, a network security that actually looked at Silicon Valley and was emulating a similar, not all the way, but emulating something to control non-competes. It's also the case that Massachusetts has been trying to pass some bill. Again, not all the way. At first it was like, let's ban non-competes, but now it's something in between. I actually, in this case, wanted to move also to the entertainment industry and kind of the creativity. There was a lot of work. You know, patents have this paper trail that is easier to count for economists, for the people who are doing the big data sets and trying to look at inventor networks and things like that. But I thought there's a lot going on in all of these industries. Mm-hmm. And actually, I was fortunate to collaborate with, this is in the UN, people from all over the world thinking about these questions. This is in Vienna, in Austria, in the UN headquarters, where we did a project on how much talent mobility is helping countries and regions develop, and we saw that happening. And then in 2016, in the summer of 2016, I got a really exciting call from the White House, which I like saying, so I'll say it again. I got a call from the White House. and they said, I was in Berlin, and I was on my way to Tel Aviv. I was there to see a Sting concert in Berlin with my best childhood friend. And they said, well, we want you to come like in a couple of weeks to, or less than that, to speak in the White House before people from the Treasury Department, the Justice Department, the Labor Department, and the President's policy team and representatives from the states, the various states, because we actually now care about non-compete policy, which was never the case when I was writing Talent Wants to Be Free, which I kept saying, nobody's looking, it's under the radar, as I said, you know, nobody's thinking about this. And suddenly there were a lot of exposés, and it was really a great time. And so it culminated into the, you know, speaking about the research in this group, you know, and forming a working group, which resulted in October 2016, so just before the turn in the administration, with a call, a president call for action to the states to actually curtail non-compete contracts, to try to pass laws that are similar to California, and to go after overreaching contracts by companies who try to really intimidate their employees from moving on to competitors. But so all of this has been wonderful, except there was a change in the administration, so some of the momentum is really passed on this. But like in Massachusetts, there are a lot of states that are thinking about the non-compete aspects. But in this book, and You Don't Own Me, it's really important for me to say, you know, it's not just about non-competes, and this I've been seeing again by working in California, seeing how even when you do away with that most blunt, you know, wording and clause that says you are just not allowed to take a job with a competitor or work in this industry, there are a lot of other ways that are contractual and in the language, in the fuzzy language of the various statutes, that have been employed to create the same kinds of effects. And so in the case of Carter Bryant, working in Southern California in the toys industry, in the entertainment industry, you know, the fashion and design industry, he had a very standard contract that said, it's an assignment contract. He also had an NDA clause, but of, you know, not disclosing anything that he sees, and very, very broadly worded, but his assignment agreement said, everything that you create, innovate, think of, design, improve, sketch, conceive of, use those words of conceive of, all the know-how that you have, and again, use that those words, whether patentable or non-patentable, whether copyrightable or non-copyrightable, all of this, during the time that you're working here with Mattel, is owned by Mattel. And that language of the clause becomes really the basis of the case. And what is really important for me to emphasize is that, as you know, all of you know, when you're studying intellectual property law, is that yes, we are in the realm already of intangible assets, but there is a spectrum of intangibility that every body of intellectual property recognizes as important to actually think about. And in each one of these bodies of law, we have alignments drawn between the sort of most intangible that will not be the subject of control and property, and those expressions or reduced to practice that actually are allowed to be propertized. So in patent law, we have that distinction about something that's abstract, and still in the ephemeral, mind concept that is not patentable, but something that's reduced to practice is patentable. In copyright, we have the distinction between idea and expression. I'm not saying that it's easy to always get that right, but we know that it's important, and we make these distinctions, and we enforce those distinctions. In trade secret law, always it's been the case that we understand trade secrets as only applying to special knowledge and not to general know-how, general skills. And that's actually, I've been criticizing the Defend Trade Secret Act the first time we have a federal statute on trade secrets. It was an opportunity to actually say that in the statute, because it's really hard for employers to actually accept, and for judges to always, understand that that's what they need to be doing. So, for example, if you've been following the Uber versus Waymo versus Uber case on the automated cars, it's the same, pattern of an ex-employee moving from one competitor to another. A few weeks ago, in the hearings, the judge, California judge that's looking at this case, said, "Wait a minute, are you telling me that an employee that moves from one competitor to another has to go undergo a lobotomy in order to work with the competitor?" And it's like, that's clearly not the case, that's not the law. But it wasn't clearly the case in the discussions, which was his point. However, at the same time, these contracts actually try to catch much more than that, and they have, as I said, in the typical contracts like Carter had, the words of conceived of, and the one of the interesting, very interesting and controversial characters in the book is Judge Kaczynski, and he looks at this contract, and on copyright, I'll skip over and say that all of these are, the leakage that I just described is a feature and not a bug in intellectual property. But in the contracts context, it's really expanding. So on the copyright side, Judge Kaczynski says, and he's been a great, person in the jurisprudence of copyright law, in kind of maintaining those, policing those lines, he says, Stephanie Meyer was free to write Twilight even though there were books about sexy vampires even before, right? That's the idea, but the concrete expression is what gets the copyright. Degas, has these pictures of dancers, but other people are free to say, oh, that's a great idea, let's just draw, dancers, and that's not protected by copyright law. But then when Kaczynski actually looks at the contract, he has a completely different language. He's like, let's remand it to understand whether when they say conceived of, they actually meant to include also all these ideas that were just in the mind and never yet, like in any sketches, and that might be on, it just depends, it's all contract, so, and almost like he's, you know, guiding the next employer, even if they might lose on this stand, or in this, in these particular facts, the next time you can get even a more expansive contract. He says the same thing about know-how, like, does know-how include all these stuff? And then he says the same thing about, and this becomes a really big issue in front of the jury to actually decide, when it says, while working at Mattel, does it mean also during the weekends and nights, when he's, you know, at sleeping? And that's actually, I describe this really important moment in the second trial where the new attorney, Jennifer O'Keller, is cross-examining the, questioning the CEO then of Mattel, Bob Eckert, and she says, okay, let's imagine that I am 18 and I have these great ideas, sketches, I draw a lot of things, I put it in my parents' house drawer, like in my, you know, childhood room, and then I go, 20 years later, I start a job at some company. I come back home for the holidays, and I pull out the drawer, the sketches. Do you own these sketches? And he sits there coldly and says, yes, very probably yes. And that was really like, the jurors told me that was a shifting moment, because I was like, how can that also be? But it was sort of open question there. The weekends and nights became a big defense by MGA. And Mattel kept saying it's not a defense. It says everything. And they brought in innovation gurus from Mattel and from other places that said, you know, those eureka moments can happen when you're at the airport going on vacation, you know, during, you know, your time off at break, the break. But it's still all inspired by your work here and its own. So I'm going to end here, and I would love to, you know, hear all of your questions and talk about anything related to these issues. But I want to say that it's beyond just the questions of what this single employee can do, and beyond, you know, what kinds of innovations we see in the different industries, although that's all very, very important. It's really how patterns, even when mobility does happen, and people are not chilled from, you know, taking that risk of moving away from their employer, it's patterned in the sense of when they make that choice, they will most likely move to a competitor rather than start off on their own, because that competitor, like what happens in MGA, can indemnify them, can step in and be that litigant. But so the biggest picture is that the whole industry is, the whole shape of the industry, how concentrated it is, how much new entry you will see, is shaped by these litigations. And I'll end with an anecdote about, you know, over-chilling speech when we don't understand, or creative expressions when we don't know the limits. So this is actually from the Financial Times, reviewed the book last week, and this is actually a little flyer that designed that Norton UK made. So my publisher in UK and Europe is much less worried about copyright issues, but here in the United States, the irony of writing a book that explains fair use and explains the limits of intellectual property and explains the limits of controlling knowledge, we had this one cover right here on the right, which everybody was very happy about. It went into all the catalogs and everything, and then, you know, just weeks before the book was going to come out, the in-house counsel said, no, we're going to be sued by Mattel. We can't do it. Too risky. And they said, and I didn't see anything about in copyright law that justifies this, but they said, the only way that we're not risking it is if we have shaded images of both dolls, not just the one doll. So that's sort of my little experience, and the buffers that are created in intellectual property and human capital law. Thank you.
We have about half an hour for questions. If people, I mean, there's a lot left out in that presentation that's super juicy in the book. Hands up. Questions for Orly? Yeah, go ahead, Lillian.
I am curious to ask, how do these non-compete clauses actually compare to what an employee at any of the companies that we do not work in the production of, you know, massively sellable materials, but what is the level of specificity that these non-compete clauses usually have, and when do they become so largely drafted that they are literally non-enforceable and do not pose really at least for the
Yeah, no, those are great questions. So there's not, you know, one answer to how they're drafted, except to say that they've been on the rise and expanding in what employers demand. First of all, employers demand, if you think about the scope from a geographical and temporal aspect, they demand larger geographies because they say competition is basically global, so you can't even, it used to be that, you know, you can't move down the street, but now you can't, you know, compete in the entire country. So we see that expansion. Temporally, actually, they've been narrowing because courts have been saying competition is so rapid these days that it's maybe no longer reasonable to require the rule of thumb of 3 years, but, you know, 1 year may be more reasonable. And all of this is in the context of non-California employment. But your question is very important because, you know, when we started seeing the empirical studies, over a decade ago, there were researchers that started saying, you know, California is really benefiting from its exceptional stance on non-compete. There were questions about whether California has all these other exceptional stuff. You know, we do yoga and all that stuff. That was really creating a lot of noise in the research. But nowadays, what the exciting empirical stuff that I've been looking at is there are these codes across all the states. This is why it's great. It's a great research area because unlike patent law, you know, that's a federal law, you have a natural experiment where even though all of these other states have reasonableness, they actually have different ideas of reasonableness. And all those questions that you just asked of, you know, how specified is the competition, like what kinds of positions can't you take, or you just say in all of the biotech industry you can't work. How much do you have to show as a litigant that there are trade secrets behind, you know, that are justifying the legitimate business interest to enforce this contract? All of these questions are answered differently with the different courts in the all the different states. And some states have actual statutes about it. So, you know, Colorado and Oregon are some examples where there were, and Hawaii and some other states have passed laws that have moved closer to California. So they're coded as sort of lower enforcement all the way to high enforcement states like Florida and Texas and Georgia and Illinois, and Boston or Massachusetts is sort of like in the middle. And that has really lent itself to a lot of, interesting studies. But then the last thing that you said is, well, when it becomes so overreaching, it will really, the employee will understand that it won't be enforced and then they won't move. I think that's, you know, questionable if that actually happens. I think a lot of times it's the reverse, that employees don't question and don't know that these will not be upheld by the courts. And that's part of what the president's call for action was about, that we already have a reasonableness requirement. So a lot of states like Illinois and New York have been leaders on this. Eric Schneiderman has been a leader in looking at big companies that have these really expansive clauses, and a similar thing is happening right now with NDAs and non-disparagement clauses, and a lot of things that are relevant to the book, but also to the moment right now of, you know, what employees can say and do. And, a lot of the activities are to actually, even with the laws that we have right now, to have this sort of preemptive move of not waiting until an employee is sued, but actually to go after an employer that's overreaching and to make them warn their employees that they're really not confined to what they think. And the Defense Trade Secret Act has a similar move in it, which was really great. It was the Peter Manel clause. Yeah. That was added after, you know, some versions and discussions where a lot of us were actually worried about, again, this overreaching of trade secrecy, prosecutorial and civil litigation activity that was chilling mobility and chilling speech. One of the sort of compromises or add-ons that eventually passed in the act was a requirement to add an immunity when employees are reporting illegalities, or a whistleblower immunity in NDAs, and to have it actually in the employment contract. And every employee contract now has to say, yes, there's this really expansive NDA, but here's when it doesn't apply, when you're talking about the, you know, the sexual harassment or you know, all these
espionage,
or espionage, right? But it's sort of, that also signals, you know, the limit. So that's a very limited exception, and everything else was sort of left untouched and got in the stamp of approval.
Other questions? Woody and then Alex.
To then build off that question, it seems like there are three different sort of aspects of these agreements that are going on. One is the IP aspect, who owns what. One is the employment aspect, and one is the NDA, don't say anything aspect.
Right.
And the Manel calls is really interesting. Does any one of those aspects bother you, or is it the combination of them that is particularly noxious? Right. So I just didn't know if it made sense to sort of isolate the problematic aspects of any of them, or if it was collective.
Yeah, that's great that you're sort of pushing me on this, but I think of them as different sides of the same coin. You know, there are bills right now before, there's the Me Too bill before Congress, and at least three bills that I know of, Pennsylvania, New York, and California, that would do something similar about just sort of accepting reporting about sexual harassment from NDAs, but also just in the case of settlements and not just the regular employment contracts at the beginning of the contractual, you know, relationship. And what I feel is that those are all too narrow, and so if I had to respond to this, I think that the biggest problem is really everything that's sort of beyond the tip of the iceberg, where we don't see what I was responding to, like the whole chilling effects of, you know, not just the litigation that happens like with MGA and Mattel, all the creativity and all the exchanges, the collaboration, and the speech about, you know, pay equity and all that. Again, we have specific laws, but I would want to give them more meat about, you know, employees understanding that they can speak and that they can create. With, you know, spanning all these employment contracts that are pre-dispute, that are really just when you start working and when you're starting your, you know, just being in these industries and your career.
Alex, so if people don't know, it's Professor Alex Roberts from UNH, otherwise known as @LexLanham on Twitter. Everyone should be following her. She's like number one prof blog on Twitter these days.
Yes, thank you. I'm really honored.
So I haven't read the book yet. I'm really looking forward to it, but it sounds like one of the really exciting parts of it is your access to all these different materials and litigation documents. And I'm getting the impression a lot of those were public, but some of them weren't, and you also conducted interviews. So I'd love to just hear a little bit more about that process, and if you met any resistance from either the companies or from the lawyers that you tried to.
Yeah, great. I mean, as I said, I was sort of inspired by Jessica's, you know, work but I was a little worried about all of that. So what I did was first really go through all the public documents, and there's a lot. So I read thousands and thousands of testimony pages of, you know, because this trial went on for a decade with, you know, trials. Carter Bryant was on the stand for weeks, and each one of these characters, and asked a lot of things about his personal life, for example, which I sort of alluded to when I read this. So I'll give you, the New Yorker also alludes to this, but it doesn't explain it. So what I describe in the book is how he, so he's gay, and they really go into his, all of his life, his childhood, his, you know, like schooling, his sketches. Mattel flies in the principal of the school in Missouri, where his parents, the Arab neighborhood where his parents live, where he says that he was actually inspired. He was on leave from his work for Mattel for a few months because he was just tired. And he says, like, his story was that he saw these schoolgirls coming out of a public high school in Missouri, and they looked sort of like, you know, brass dolls. They were multi-ethnic, their hair was crazy, and they were cool. They had, you know, all this fashion that had nothing to do with Barbie, you know, like that cold, icy, you know, white, never-changing doll. And so they fly in the principal, and they request the yearbooks of all these schools. And she's sitting there at the, you know, the stand in court, and like they're like, does this look anything like her? They're like, you know, like, and they're like cross-examining, like everybody's on her case of like, do her students at the school really look like this, and could they be clean? And really the underlying tone of this is like, no, Southern California is like where the cool stuff happens. How could it be that, you know, Missouri inspired fashion and things like that? There was a lot of that. But, you know, the short of it is that there's a lot in the trial itself that gave me a lot of information. Oh, so one of the things that in the first trial was allowed, and the second trial the judge reprimanded the attorneys, and also questioned the decisions of the first federal judge, who actually retired very early, like he was in his 40s, and he left the federal bench as Steve Larson was the first judge. And he made a lot of questionable decisions in the case. There was evidence of racism in the jury, and he did away with that. And Judge Kaczynski told me, you know, like, he was so glad that he actually had to remand it on the other substantive decisions, because he didn't really know, like, how he would do, you know, work with the racism expressions. But on the Carter Bryant computer, so they tried to show that he had some what they call porn, like gay porn, and they tried that, like, a lot of what I heard from the attorneys, and this again, I kind of saw this in the files, but then I understood it more when all the attorneys were very willing to speak, which is really interesting. Like, they were the first to be willing to speak, and that there were these underlying messages that he had an unhealthy interest in children, all kinds of things that was really baseless, totally baseless. And the second judge said he couldn't believe that, like, he was allowed to be questioned about his sexuality and all kinds of things. So that was part of what was going on. Again, how did I get to, the attorneys were really happy to talk. In the book, I kind of describe how I felt like the executives were almost like life imitating art, because Isaac Larian is very similar to Bratz, and the Mattel executives are very, like, Bob Eckert is very similar to Barbie in a lot of stuff. But Isaac Larian, of course, really wanted to talk and really wanted, and his in-house counsel got really worried later on after he sat with me in his boardroom for a long time and, you know, talked about everything and, you know, bad-mouthed everybody, not only Mattel, but everybody. He's been in litigation against McDonald's and Walmart and Pixar, and, like, he says about himself that he's sort of, like, almost his wife says he's dumb, he's invested all his, you know, it's part of the story is sort of the tragedy of courtroom drama and litigation where you could focus so much of your creative energies elsewhere, and that the big winners are the attorney teams that got $600 million in legal fees in this single case, and everybody else is sort of, you know, whether they're winners and they're roller coaster winners and losers, but not really winners in any way. But then Bob Eckert, who was ousted following the case and not unrelated, you know, gets out. He was actually, so this again, this is the attorneys telling me all kinds of anecdotes and really cool stuff, and you have to read the book about just his personality. But he was being groomed when he was in at Mattel. The rumor was that he was being groomed to be the CEO of McDonald's next. But he totally, after this whole debacle, and he was questioned about toys that killed children, and why he was questioned by Congress about why he didn't recall, fast enough, and Jennifer Keller did a fabulous job in really kind of getting to the culture at Mattel. I tried a lot to talk to him, and eventually I got an email from him that he no longer works at Mattel. He was very polite, and that he no longer speaks about anything related to Mattel, and I include the email that he sent me. But I did get to talk to some other people at Mattel. It was sort of representative of the whole way that the willingness of people to tell their story was very much kind of correlated to the dynamic in the courtroom. I'll tell one more anecdote from the book, which is that it became very clear that the Mattel people and the executives did not want to be in the courtroom. I mean, they wanted to use Quinn Emanuel, their bully firm, which is a word that the other side said, that to just, like, litigate. You had that chapter, one of the chapters from the book about how just they litigate against everybody, the artists, so it's not just about, you know, the competitors, but the musicians, the film producers, have been their repeat law firm. But they didn't want physically to be there, and they got really annoyed. Eckert got really, really annoyed that he has to drive in the traffic of LA to the courtroom. and at some point, it was such sharp contrast with Isaac Larian sitting there every day with his wife and his kids, and, like, you know, just being very. It was very like, this is my company. This is my baby. I invented it. Like, there's a lot of stories ways that he describes, like, what inspired him to invent Bratz. So there's already some contest there. And by the way, when you read the book, you'll see that there's already an inception of Barbie, which, of course, litigation and a lot of parents claiming that baby. But eventually the court in the second trial, David Carter, the judge, says, actually, you have to be here, Bob Eckert, just like Isaac Larian is here every day, and you have to, you know, just drive. And he gets so furious, and his handlers are like, they don't know what to do. And eventually, they come up with this idea. And again, this is an anecdote that I could just know from talking to the insiders. They call up the law enforcement people nearby the courtroom, and say, we need to use your landing point for the helicopter, for Mattel's helicopter, because Eckert cannot sit in traffic every day. And they respond, no, but this is for emergencies, you know, like, and no, they didn't really understand, like, and there's some back and forth of, you know, what's your price, just name the price, and they're like, no, it's not for sale, it's a land, it's like an emergency helicopter landing. So yeah, it's just sort of fleshing out more of the personalities, and I have that in a lot of the characters, you know, asking Kaczynski about his past and all that, and how that shapes the people's, the actors in this case, willingness to be in this whole battle and how they behave.
So questions, Jim?
So your study showed that California approach was better for growth than some other approaches. Would you go further and impose some sort of regime in which if you bring one of these lawsuits, like as Mattel did, and fail, you can pay attorney's fees, you pay a punishment, would you think that would be a good direction?
I think so, yes. I think that's a really important part of it, that it is a strategy of a lot of these very, very strong, wealthy companies to litigate even with losing cases, and in the second trial there are in some of these statutes there are attorney's fees that are owed, but you know in the Copyright Act you have that, and you have California laws on this, but I think that should be impose more, and I think in the second trial, Judge Carter says this, that if we didn't have a plaintiff here that was willing, or a defendant here, sorry, that was willing to go all the way until the end where he wins eventually, Isaac Larian, but also can't pay his attorney, so actually Isaac Larian becomes in some sort of litigation with a lot of his former attorneys, which left like Warwick and some of the other big firms, and that's why he brings on Jennifer Keller, part of the reason that like he actually has to switch attorney and his insurance doesn't want to cover any more of this litigation. But yes, there is imposition of the legal fees, partly because there's counterclaims, but partly because of these statutes. And I think, again, there's even more than just the legal fees when you go all the way. There should be sort of ways earlier on to see how do you allow defense. Some of these cases with artists, the only reason we see them actually winning is that the ACLU got behind them. That's the Foresight case and some other cases. Whereas we don't know about all these other artists that are getting cease and desist letters and they're like, I'm never gonna risk this even though it's clearly fair use. I just can't afford hiring a lawyer.
For the students in the classroom, she mentioned the Foresight case. That's the malted Barbie, the Barbie in the blender, and the Barbie in the martini I showed you in class. So Tom Foresight had the ACLU helping him with that case. Other questions? Andrea.
First of all, welcome. Thank you. So as you're tracking the evolution of the assignment of inventions, clauses, and standalone agreements, have you noticed their overreach extending to physical monitoring of employees? Uh-huh. So there was a recent case with an employee litigating because she turned off her cell phone and the employer deemed that to be a violation of her terms. But in a world where they own any ideas that, from inception in the shower, that seems to open the door to more invasive physical tracking, even to, especially when employers are stealing chips and bodies now, right?
And Woody is even more the expert on all of these questions, but I think it is very related. So I think that a lot of invasions on privacy are justified by this existence of a very, very broad definition of trade secrets, as well as the existence of broad definitions of what is allowed and what is not allowed to be said and done in the workplace. And so it really is becomes sort of a tension between some laws, like, you know, we want to prevent sexual harassment, so we're going to read all your emails and things like that. It's I've thought a bunch about these questions of sort of intrusiveness. My colleague at Michigan, Sam Bagatsas, for example, was very, very worried about all the technologies that you alluded to now, like the wellness technologies and programs with employees. Sort of like, now we need to know everything that you're doing for all of these reasons. So you won't take anything, and you might be, and in the book I described how, like, there was that kind of monitoring of Mattel when they became more and more suspicious of all of these poaching activities and so on. They became also more invasive in their employees' lives. And so that's typical, but also because we want to control behaviors and we want to nudge towards healthy lifestyle and all of these things. So there's a lot of reasons why we're seeing an expansion privacy intrusion, and it's something. Yeah, it's something that we should be concerned about. You know, there's some good things about, you know, knowing more, but the, you know, those lines between your private life and your work life, I think should be thought about.
Kristen.
You mentioned that you talked to jurors. I was curious whether there were any differences in the way the jurors viewed the case and the way the attorneys thought about the case, or the way that the attorneys thought the jurors would view the case.
Yeah, it's the first time I interviewed jurors, so it was a really interesting learning experience for me to see that just what resonated with the jurors is so different. Like, the attorneys talk about all the legalistic stuff and all the causes of action and their strategies, and that's not what they remember afterwards, the jurors. It really is about sort of the dynamic in the trial and, like, how much they liked these people, both the attorneys and the plaintiffs and the litigants. So I heard from the jurors, I've heard stuff like, and one juror actually pulled out, like, her notebook that she kept during the trial, and she actually showed me, like, when Bob Eckert was speaking, she just wrote liar, like, and she just felt he was this cold person. And he said, and then, you know, who was actually present, like, Isaac Larian, you could see, she said, you could see he sat there and he cared so much about the dolls. And Isaac Larian, what the attorneys, his attorneys said about him, and then I saw when I met him, He's actually really savvy about, like, the picture that he paints, and so one of the attorneys told me that he suggested to her this strategy of, like, giving a Bratz doll and a Mattel doll to Eckert on the stand and making him understand who, or, like, say which is which, like, which is our product and which is your product. And she's like, of course he'll know this. And he's like, no, he won't know his own products. He kept saying, like, he wanted to be interviewed a lot. So he said also to the media, he said to me, that CEO, he comes from cheese. You know, because he was the CEO of Kraft. He thinks about selling toys, just like he thinks about selling cheese. And he really sort of showed how he's passionate. Like, he brought his kids, and, like, how his kids inspired. You know, he had this whole, they wanted to keep Carter Bryant a secret. They did. Like, it's clear. It's not, you know, it's not that they were, you know, innocent in that sense. And so he had all these confusing stories about how he invented Isaac Larian, how he invented Bratz, which included, like, his daughter inspired it and all this. But in any event, all of this really inspired, like, resonated with the jurors. And in that moment, like, they remember this moment where Eckert has given these dolls, and he's like, he doesn't, like, they really saw that he doesn't, like, love his products, and then that Larian really loves his products. And that was really, to them, like, here's
a company that really is passionate, and why should Mattel own, you know, this other empire that they did not develop?
That feels like a really risky move to give right. Eckert the two dolls, because he could show that he knows what.
Right, and he actually did get it right eventually, but just like that hesitation and the kind of not showing the emotion.
Not knowing certainly helps, but I was it was cross examination. So to give them the two dolls, to assume that he might get it wrong, I feel like it's a risky trial move.
Right.
The lawyer must have known had a good sense that he was going to hesitate.
Well, it was,
and that surprises. I'm like, I don't think I would do that on cross examination, not knowing what my key witness was going to do.
Right, but what was interesting that she was hesitant about that move, but it was Larian that really pushed her.
Oh, interesting.
He has a really she said he has really good instincts about how to present the trial to the jurors.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
So just to pause, so that's about the jurors have a particular conception of ownership. I mean, do you think it was an emotional response to the people, or do you think it has to do with the way that they perceive ownership and who should have the right to them?
Yeah, so I think it's a mix. I think again, the two trials came out differently, and even in the second trial, like, there was just one hold up like that. Eventually, it was unanimous, but what they told me in the deliberations was there was like one, he was an Asian American immigrant who came from, I think from China, and he told the other jurors that, no, there's, you know, like a contract should be a contract, and he's seen a lot of like stealing of IP, and he just felt more strongly about like they shouldn't take the another company's ideas, and they had this contract with their employees, and so they did think about all these issues. And the other jurors thought, no, this is so unfair. People should have the right to their careers and ideas when they're doing things during the weekends and nights and time off, and when, you know, then. And they leave, and it was clear that Mattel didn't want to develop. It was very clear in the trial that Mattel would not have developed rats ever, right? Like, unless there's actually competition that puts out rats. But then, you know, again, the first trial, they were just sort of guided by by Judge Larson to say, was there a contract that said that everything that Carter Bryant did was owned by Mattel, and they said yes, and then they gave he sell this idea and the sketches and the word he developed, the name Bratz, sold it to the competitor 2 weeks before he left to the company, and so a win for Mattel. So they thought about the legal issues, but what I mean is that they didn't think about it in sort of these very like clean, you know, terms of how we think about the doctrine. They thought about it in fairness and story, kind of storytelling terms.
All right, thank you, Orly. Thank you so much.